welcome to Online Merge. Just a few quick announcements. You know, actually, we weren't supposed to have Merge tonight because on the original calendar, we were supposed to be setting up for our garage sale. Unfortunately, because of the virus and all the restrictions in place of the number of people that can gather together, we have to postpone our garage sale, and we don't have a future date at this time because there's still a lot of unknowns of when we can gather together and coordinate our schedules and calendars and all that kind of stuff. But be on the lookout for information in coming weeks about garage sale. Other announcements and other opportunities for you remain the same this week. On Wednesday, we will have online Zoom Bible study at 6 p.m., and you are all invited to join us for that as we study the third chapter of Jonah. And then next Sunday night at 6 o'clock, we'll have online Merge again for you as we worship and praise God's name together and grow together wherever we are. And so tonight, we're going to do just that, and we're going to lift up God and his name, and we're going to see what his word has for us this evening. So before we get started, or as we kick off our worship together, we're going to be reminded and united in our mission-driven statement. So if you will join me, please. We are driven, passion, to know Christ and make him known, pursuit of righteousness and the lost, and purpose from him, in him, for him. Take it away, Stephen.
Nothing can separate, even if I ran away. Your love never fails. I know I still make mistakes, but you have new mercies for me every day. Your love never fails. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Your love never fails. The wind is strong and the water's deep, but I'm not alone here in these open seas, 'cause your love never fails. The chasm is far too wide. I never thought I'd reach the other side, 'cause your love never fails.
You're same through the ages.
'Cause you stay the same through the ages, and your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Your love never fails. And you make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. And you make all things work together for my good.
And you make all things work together for my good. And you make all things work together for my good. And you make all things work together for my good. Oh, you stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Your love never fails. Your love never fails.
Do you believe that his love never fails? Do you believe that he works all things together for your good, for my good? That when the storms rage, we're not going to be lost. He's right there. He's going to save us and walk us through. You know, we're living in a very strange time, and a time when a lot of us are dealing with disappointment and schedules and calendars that have just been jumbled up or erased. And we may be feeling anxious, we may feel a loss of sense of control, and we need to be reminded and brought back in that his love never fails. And he's going to work all things, even those disappointments that we have, he's going to work all things together for our good and for his glory. And I hope and I pray that you do believe that in the core of who you are, no matter what circumstances and what feelings and emotions that you may have right now or tomorrow afternoon or Wednesday night at 11 o'clock at night or whenever it might be, that we might be reminded that his love never fails us. So let's go to the Lord and let's pray together and share what is on our hearts and our concerns before the Lord. Let's welcome him in this place as well. Would you pray with me? Lord God, we ask that you would remind us, no matter what is happening in our reality, in our lives, on this planet, that your love never fails us, that you will work all things together for our good and for your glory, Lord. Help us to trust that. And so now at this time, God, wherever we are, on the stage, in the station, or on our back patio, or in our bedroom at home, wherever we are, Lord, watching this video and worshiping you, we take a moment and we pray, God, for the burdens on our hearts, for the disappointments, for the answers that we seek from you, from the people that we're worried about. And so, Lord, please hear the prayers, hear the people, hear the circumstances that we lift to you at this time. Lift your prayers to the Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And we continue, God, to come before you, and we pray for wisdom, for our government leaders, for all those making decisions that affect each one of us. Lord, we pray for the medical community, for those in other places of employment and front lines that are risking their health to keep society going, to keep life going, Lord. We pray for a cure. We pray for a remedy. We pray most of all for your salvation and your peace and your guidance during this time, Lord. For those who are grieving, those who are out of work, Lord, those who are just facing disappointment or facing depression, Lord, we lift them all to you, and we trust you, and we invite you, Jesus, into this place of worship. And we ask that you would open your word to us, Lord. Help us to look to you. You are the source of life. You are the source of all that we need. And we thank you, and we praise you for who you are. It's in Jesus' name that we ask these things and we pray these things. Amen. Okay, so our traffic sign tonight, we're in a sermon series called Rules for the Road. And tonight our traffic sign is one that isn't that popular. It's not a very frequent sign that you see on everyday drives. And it is the look sign. The look sign. And we're going to talk about that in just a moment. But before we get there, I'm going to put up three images. And now these are from personality tests. And you're supposed to go with what is the first thing that you see when you look at these pictures. Now, I don't have the diagnostic tools of what it means either way. But I want to see and ask you to look at these pictures with me and decide what it is that you see. So here's the first image. When you look at that, what do you see? Some people see a duck. That's the first thing they see is a duck. Some people see a rabbit. Which did you see first, a duck or a rabbit? Here's the bigger question. Can you, after I suggested to you what you were supposed to see, when you look at it, can you see them? Can you see the images, the duck or the rabbit? Here's the second image. Do you see a young woman or do you see an old woman? The young woman has a feather in her hat and is looking away to the right. The old woman has a feather coming out, and this is her nose and this is her chin, and she's looking down. Can you see both images in the same picture? Look for it. Young woman or old woman? And sometimes we can train our eyes at, what am I trying to see? Am I trying to see the young woman? Then I can see the young woman. If I'm trying to see the old woman, then I can see the old woman. It is what we're looking for sometimes is what we see. Okay, here's the third one. What do you see first? The word good or the word evil? Because they're both there. Good is spelled out in the black, and evil is spelled out inside the letters of the word good. What do you see, and what did you see first, good or evil? Again, I'm not going to say I have the answers to these personality questions. I don't know what it means if you saw evil before you saw good, or if you saw the old woman before the young woman, or whether you saw the rabbit before the duck. I don't have the answers to that, but here's what I know. You had to look. You had to look at the images to even see anything. So our road sign today is the word look. And the road sign, the purpose of where you find it most often is at railroad crossings that do not have the automatic warning bars or the things that, you know, the flashing lights and all the things that come down to stop you at a railroad crossing. There are so many railroad crossings around this country that don't have flashing lights or safety bars. All they have are little pole signs that say railroad crossing coming up and the sign that says look. Stop. That's what you're supposed to do at a railroad crossing, okay? Even if there aren't any lights, okay, you're supposed to stop and you need to look this direction and you need to look that direction before you go across the tracks and continue on your route. If you don't stop and look both ways, tragedy can happen, right? A train literally could come around the corner and hit a car that was on the tracks. What does the look sign have to mean, or can it mean, for you and for me in relation to God's word and in relation to what God would have us to know about the truths found in his word? So the look sign while you're driving, if you see it, know I'm coming up to probably railroad tracks or an intersection, something that I need to be intentional with my focus, intentional with what I'm looking at and what is around me. And that is what God is calling us to do when we see the look sign. The word look means an intentional focus. If I tell you, you know, the line from Superman, look, it's a bird, it's a plane, it's Superman. Look, it's an intentional focus. Take your eyes off of what you're doing and focus it here, okay? Sometimes people will be on their phone or on their iPad or watching TV and somebody's trying to talk to them. And what do they say? Look, look at me. Look at me. Are you really giving me your attention and your focus? And a lot of times we're not. We're distracted. We say, yeah, I hear you, I hear you. But really we're reading at the same time and we're not really paying attention. What does it mean when God says to look? What are we supposed to be focusing on? And really we can go back to the greatest commandment when Jesus is questioned, which is the greatest commandment? And he says, love the Lord your God with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. So when we see the look sign, what I want to challenge you to do is the first thing we do is we look up. We look to God. And here's the thing. When we look to something, it's to rely upon something. If we look to the Lord, it means we rely and we're dependent on his help. That's where our help is going to come. Look, we're all in a tough situation right now. Some of us harder than others. Some of us dealing with greater disappointment and loss than others. But regardless, we're all going through a hard time. And instead of looking away from God or looking to the world or looking to ourselves or looking to material things or other things that can help us to get us through, we need to look up. Our first gaze, our first focus, our intentional effort that we set our eyes on should be to the Lord. Look at Psalm 121. It says, I lift my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Who are you looking to help you? To help you through your boredom? To help you through your disappointment, to help you through your worry, to help you with your relational problems, to help you with whatever. Who is your help? What is your help? The psalmist reminds us, I lift my eyes to the hills. I lift up. Where does my help come from? It comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He is our help. We've got to look up first. This verse reminds me, and maybe it was the inspiration from a true story that happened in 2 Kings. Elisha, the nation of Israel is being attacked by a foreign invader, foreign country. The king of Aram is sending all these people, and Elisha's servant is in fear because Elisha is a prophet, and he is able to tell, and they warn the king. They say, look, there is a prophet in Israel who is telling the Hebrew people what it is that the king dreams at night. Okay, he was a prophet and he was saying, look, this is what this king is doing, or they're going to attack. Somehow he knows. And so they said, take troops, go. They're going to attack him and go capture Elisha the prophet and bring him back to me. Well, Elisha's servant is fearful. And then Elisha says, don't be afraid, because Elisha's eyes were open and he knew that the Lord was going to fight for them. And in verse 16, he says, oh, Lord, what should we do? He says, don't be afraid. Those who are with us are much greater than those who are with them. And then look at verse 17. And Elijah prayed, oh, Lord, open his eyes so he may see. Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked and saw the hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. You and I don't always see the army of saints, the army around us that God has to help us in our time of need. Just like Elisha here, they were not alone. May this be our prayer, and this is my prayer to you. Oh, Lord, open her eyes that she can see. Open his eyes that, he, that he can see. He's not in this alone. She's not fighting this alone. You, Lord, are with her. And you, Lord, are with all of us, and you will provide the help. Give us eyes to see. How do we get those eyes? We have to look upon the Lord. We have to look up. We have to look up. The second thing the look sign challenges us to do is to look out for our neighbors. Look out for others. So we look up and we look out. And where do we find this example? Well, if you turn to Matthew chapter 14, starting in verse 13, when Jesus heard what had happened, what happened? His cousin, John the Baptist, was just beheaded by Herod. That was the news that Jesus just received. That's traumatic. That's devastating. It's heart-crushing and wrenching. Here, his cousin not just died, but in such a violent way. And it was most likely would have caused Jesus not just emotional and psychological hurt and pain, but as he then thought about his own upcoming death, that he would sacrifice his life on the cross. So when Jesus hears this news about his cousin, John the Baptist, it says he withdrew by boat privately to a solitary place. You know, when we get bad news, like, we need time to process. We need time to grieve. We need time to get away from the noise and the pressures and the demands of everybody around us. And we just need some time away. And that's what Jesus tries to do in verse 13. When he had heard what happened, he withdrew by boat privately to a solitary place. Hearing of this, the crowds followed him on foot from the town. So Jesus is in a boat, and he's sailing out. He's trying to get to the other side to a solitary place. The crowds hear that Jesus is going to the other side, and they walk on foot, and they wait for him. Now, a lot of us would be aggravated or frustrated or downright mad. Like, how can you be so selfish and not give me the time I need to grieve? We probably wouldn't think anything bad of Jesus if the human side of him was, I need some time. But that's not what happens. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them and healed their sick. He had compassion on them and healed their sick. He wasn't just looking inward. Guys, we are supposed to look inward. The psalmist tells us that in 139. Search my heart, O God. Help me to look and see if there's any wicked way in me. We are supposed to have some sort of introspection. But we live in a culture where it is so me first, selfie generation, that it's a disability, it's a liability, it's unbiblical how much we focus on us and our needs. And Jesus doesn't do that. When he sees the crowd, he had compassion on them and healed their sick. And then it says, as evening approached, the disciples came to him and said, this is a remote place and it's getting late. Send the crowds away so they can go to the villages and buy themselves some food. So it wasn't like they were like, 8 people there, or maybe even 50 people. Definitely not social distancing happening here on the other side of the lake. There was a huge crowd, so that when Jesus goes over, maybe in the morning or early afternoon or whenever it was that he set sail, it has now been hours that he is showing compassion and healing the sick and healing people. So much so that the disciples are like, Jesus, you need to go ahead and let them go so they have time to get to the market, get their daily bread, and get some food to eat. But Jesus replied, they do not need to go away. You give them something to eat. You give them something to eat. Stop looking at yourself, Peter, James, John. Stop looking inward. Look up. Look out. You look out and you see all these people. Have compassion and try to meet their need. How do they meet the need? They go and they gather some fish and 2 loaves. This is all we could find. And what does Jesus do? He looks up. He looks up to God and he offers prayers and praise and thanks, and he blesses the food, and it is multiplied and passed out, and the disciples are passing out all this food, so much so that at the end there's so much left over after everybody is satisfied that there are 12 basketfuls left over. Friends, if you're struggling, and even if you're not, but if you are struggling during this time, stop looking inward so much. Stop looking inward so much and look up to where your help comes from and look out and see the need. And I'm telling you, you will be satisfied because the Lord will fill you. He will provide for you and he will lift you. It's crazy. It really is. It's a weird formula for how we can find peace and fulfillment and satisfaction and the purpose when we look to God and we look to others before ourselves. But I'm telling you, it is the example Jesus set for us, and it works. It works for you, and it will work for me. So when I'm struggling, I need to remember these words. I need to look up to God. And I need to look out around me. Who needs my help? And what is their need? And how can I meet it? And maybe I can't meet it on my own, but supernaturally with God, we can meet the need. There are a lot of people who have needs. And listen to what James says. In James chapter 4, verse 17. If it's not enough that Jesus set the example for us, look at this. Anyone then who knows the good he ought to do and doesn't do it sins. Anyone, he or she, anyone, that's you, that's me, that's if anyone sees the good that they ought to do and they don't do it, we're sinning against God. That's because we're being selfish or maybe being lazy or we're just procrastinating or we're just not opening our eyes to see. Take the blinders off. Take our eyes up out of the, 10 inches from our eyes to our phone or our iPad. And look around. And then be filled with compassion as Jesus was. I love that the look, by looking up and looking out, is the sign of the cross. We look up and we look out. We look up to God, he is our help, and we look out for others, and we serve. And somehow by doing that, we are filled up. I want to challenge you. Yes, look inward, look at your heart, look at your desires, look at your needs, and present them to the Lord with thanksgiving. But then we've got to look up to where our help comes from, and we've got to look out for each other. We got to look out for our neighbors and then do something. Because if you see the good, you know the good you ought to do and you don't do it, it's a sin. It's a sin for me. Be the hands, be the feet of Jesus right now during this pandemic. Know who to look to and to look out for. Would you pray with me? Lord God, give us your eyes. Help us to remove the blinders. It's so easy just to look at ourselves and our own needs and our own wants. God, and some of our needs are really big. They really are. I'm not diminishing that at all. I have great needs too. My family has great needs too. But God, we can be consumed with ourselves. Remind us. Help us open our eyes that we may see you clearly and who you are. This virus cannot touch you. This pandemic does nothing to diminish your strength, your qualities, your provision, your love, your forgiveness, everything that you are. This virus cannot touch you. So help us to look to you. You are where our help comes from. And God, give us the strength and the compassion and the heart of Jesus that we would look out. We'd look out for one another. We'd look out for our neighbors, even strangers. We would look out and see the needs. And we'd be like Jesus and be filled with compassion and then move to action. And just like the disciples, they obeyed Jesus and they saw a miracle happen. Lord, use us. We offer all that we have. It may not be much. Lord, we offer it. Help us to look and see. In your name, amen.
My foes are many, they rise against me, but I will hold my ground. And I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way, and my help is on the way. And oh my God, he will not delay, my refuge and strength always. And I will not fear, his promise is true, my God will come through always, always. Trouble surrounds me, chaos abounding, and my soul will rest in you. That I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way, and my help is on the way. And oh my God, he will not delay, and my refuge and strength always. And I will not fear, his promise is true, and my God will come through always, always. I lift my eyes up, my help comes from the Lord. And I lift my eyes up, my help comes from the Lord. And I lift my eyes up, my help comes from the Lord. And I lift my eyes up, my help comes from the Lord. And oh my God, he will not delay, and my strength always. And I will not fear, his promise is true, and my God will come through always, always.
I lift my eyes up. My help comes from the Lord. lift up your eyes. And when you see the look sign, whether it's at a railroad sign or just out at a crazy intersection, if you see the look sign, may you think, I'm going to look up to the God, the maker of heaven and earth. From there my help comes. And I'm going to look out for other people. What are the needs around me? There is an awesome song written by Matthew West several years ago called Give Me Your Eyes. And I'm going to post the link on Facebook page and send it to your life group leaders. And you guys can punch that into your search engine and watch that video with the lyrics. And then make it your prayer. God, give me your eyes. Help me to look and see the needs that are around me, that I can be a source of compassion and help. We love you guys, and we cannot wait until we can all gather back together again and worship in person. But until that time, let's bless one another, and let's trust in the Lord. So here we go. We're going to do our benediction together. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Love you guys. See you next week.